co-author, correct. Thank you. Sorry about that. All right. We are live on LinkedIn now. So good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are when you're watching this. And welcome to Heidi and Company. Laugh, love, thrive, alive on a Friday afternoon. Woo-hoo. And this week I have a special guest. So we have with us Kris Girrell, who is co-author of an incredible book about transforming our lives called Typhoon Honey. Let's get Kris give us a little bit of a rundown, a background, a blurb on the book, if you would.
Sure. So two things about the book that I would have you know before picking it up, or, you know, to entice you to pick it up. One is, what's the name Typhoon Honey all about? The yes. Second is, what is the book about? So let me address the second one first. And that's, you know, Typhoon Honey is a book that pulls back the curtain on transformation, how it actually works. You know, so this is not hocus pocus crap. This is not some, you know, woo-woo mysticism or anything like that. It actually is based in science. Transformation was researched long and hard, starting back in the 60s. And there's a whole ton of research on how human beings transform as opposed to changing. And I distinguish between change and transformation, because change is reacting or adopting or adapting to something outside of you, something that's happened. And, you know, there's a change in the environment. There's a change in the workforce. There's a change in the software that I'm using. And I used to be comfortable with this form, and now I have to learn a whole new one. And so, you know, change is adapting to those external forces. Transformation is really an alteration of the ground level belief system that you operate from. You know, that so we build this operating system, if you will, this set of core beliefs based on our experiences and our life training. Everything that's happened to us up to this point informs and forms what it is that we react out of. And so the researchers back in the 60s and 70s, what they were looking at was, how do we supplant what's already there and alter that so that, you know, what happens is that we act and react differently, because the source code that we're coming from is different. We've changed the bottom template. So what Typhoon Honey is really about is a chance to explore what is that science from psychology, from physics, you know, from real scientific research. What, you know, what explains how that, you know, that works? And then, you know, we go through talking about, you know, what are some of the tools of transformation and how do we continually transform throughout our lives? So that's kind of what the book is about. But what's this name, Typhoon Honey?
What is Typhoon Honey?
Well, there's two answers. One is, typhoons are stronger than hurricanes. In fact, they're the strongest force on the planet Earth. They are bigger, more massive, more powerful than anything else that we know. And then juxtaposed against that, honey is one of the oldest food sources that we know of. There are cave drawings in southern France that are 5,000 years old that show people on kind of trees and poking sticks at honey, at beehives to collect honey. So we know that people were collecting honey at least 5,000 years ago. But what's interesting about honey is, not only is it pure and sweet and crystal clear and glistens in the sun and smells great and all that, but it never spoils. It's the only food that won't rot or mold. So it's pure. You know, so you have on one hand the pure power of nature's force, and the other hand you have the pure purity of clean, wholesome, rich food that's an ancient food. That would be one answer, to juxtapose those two things together and say, you know, like, what are these forces of sweet and power? when they come together. The other answer is that Typhoon Honey is actually the name of a tour guide in Vietnam. And my co-author, Candace Sogren, who is the co-founder of Boston Breakthrough Academy, and I work very closely with her and the Academy. When Candace was married, she and her husband went to Southeast Asia for their honeymoon. And they had this tour guide who called himself Typhoon Honey. You can actually look him up on YouTube and on Google him up. And he's an actual real guy and you can hire him. But Typhoon Honey was infectiously joyful. You could not be anything except for happy and joyful and giggly around him. Candace says he has the most infectious giggle. He doesn't laugh, he giggles. And kind of like the Dalai Lama giggles, you know?
Right.
He has that funny giggle. And he giggled at everything. He laughed at his own jokes. He laughed, because he met people, he called everybody, not my love, but my love, my love, my love. So Candace and I now refer to each other as my love, my love, my love, when we talk to each other. My love, my love, my love. Because Typhoon Honey was that kind of person. So he's also he's the namesake of this book because he created a way of being that is so powerful that other people around him have to be like that. There's no other way to be with Typhoon Honey except to be joyful.
Wow.
I've several occasions I've been able to be in the presence of Thich Nhat Hanh, the late Buddhist monk from Vietnam. And Thich Nhat Hanh's way of being was peace. So peaceful that when you walked into that bubble that was around him, and it was huge. I mean, it was like anytime you got within proximity of Thich Nhat Hanh, you felt peaceful. And there was no other way to be. There just wasn't. I mean, you can't come in there. I'd come in there like running 90 miles an hour because I lived a very high speed, high pressure kind of career. And I come into one of these workshops or something like that, and I literally would crash. I mean, like almost faceplant because the level of peace that was in the room around Tay was just so amazing that it just settled me down. And it was an amazing kind of way of being. So what Typhoon Honey is really about, in addition to pulling back the curtain on how it works, it's really about how to create a way of being in yourself that others around you have no other choice but to be also, to be so powerful in your way of being that you cause other people to transform with you. So that's kind of the gist of the book. And we had a gas writing it. We have a lot of personal examples and people examples, people that we know and love and have blended together, you might even find yourself in there, Heidi. But we've done it in such a way that, no individual is really singled out, but really it's kind of, here's a class of individuals that, we take some of that person's story and some of this person's story and kind of say, this is what happens when you walk this way or you talk that way. So that's the starter foundation of the talk.
So how would you say, if you were going to say this was one of your series of books, which it is, how would it connect to the other spiritual books that you've written?
What a great question. I have to admit that my books are, on the surface, look radically different. One of the first books I wrote was a book on marriage, which was kind of a lighthearted, men looking at men, talking to men about what doesn't work and what does work in marriage and how
that
to,
was the men's
married man survival guide. And we wrote it as a jungle survival guide. You know, it's like, you know, because marriage is this hot, steamy place. You know, the jungle is the source of life. I mean, the jungle, you know, produces most of the oxygen that we breathe on this planet. The jungle produces most of the pharmaceuticals that we use on this planet. And so it's a great source of life, but it also is full of things that will eat you, you know, like little tiny ants that will chew you up into thousands of pieces, or pythons and, you know, jaguars that will, you know, have you for lunch and things like that. So marriage is kind of the same way. And so what we look at is how you can enter into the jungle and be more prepared to survive in that jungle, because it is steamy and lush and luscious and sweet and sensuous and juicy and steamy and all that kind of stuff, and we love it. The second group of books that I wrote were a couple of books on something called The Dark Night of the Soul, which is transformation. Again, only it's spiritual transformation. And I was on Wisdom yesterday talking about the spiritual transformation that happens in the process called The Dark Night of the Soul, which is an impasse you get to when all the belief systems that you had, all that substrate that I was talking about, you know, that's you know, comes from all of your experience up to this point, then it kind of is the meaning making system for when you look out into the world and say, oh, okay, that's, you know, my world is at ease and it exists this way. All of a sudden in the spiritual crisis, your belief system no longer explains what you're experiencing. So your experience is radically different in a kind of a theistic sense. You know, a lot of people have this belief in a deity that you know, causes nice things to happen to nice people and bad things to happen to bad people. And then, you know, we have an experience like, you know, Newtown, Connecticut, where some, you know, crazy person takes an AR-15 and, you know, shoots 30 children, innocent children. And you say, like, well, wait a minute, you know, that's not supposed to happen in my world as I understand it, you know, and yet it happened. The reality, the grief, the pain and the despair that you experience in a situation like that is so immense that you can't deny it, you know, and you can't say, well, wait a minute. So this belief I had in a God that prevents bad things from happening to good people doesn't work anymore. And so what happens to a lot of people in spiritual transformation is they often lose their faith. Because that simplistic view no longer explains the complexities of life. What's really supposed to happen is that experience is supposed to, you know, decompose, disrupt the old belief so that you evolve into a newer belief that does work within the constructs of modern complex life. So belief systems need to change just the same as operating systems do. So I have a couple of books on The Dark Night of the Soul that are about spiritual transformation, because that's really the hardest transformation of all. Because beliefs that we have about, you know, God or the universe or, you know, everything are so foundational to our existence that it's really hard to dislodge them. And when they get dislodged, it's painful. People actually experience physical pain. They go into deep depression and despair. The first book was called Wrestling the Angel, after the Jacob experience of, you know, the all night wrestling match where he wrestled with the angel. You know, what we're doing essentially in spiritual crisis is we're wrestling with those angels, and we are changed by that, you know, Jacob was, you know, his name was changed, and his physiology was changed. The angel touched him on the hip or on the groin, one or the other, because Jacob was a philandering kind of, son of a guy. I mean, he was a cheat, a liar, and a thief, and everything. Okay. But they changed his name to Israel. What's interesting about theology is I'm a student of theology and I love it. I find it fascinating, but I had to find, you know, how the ancients talked about transformation, because they didn't have a language of ego psychology. You know, they didn't have anything that we use to talk about transformation today. So how did they describe it? Well, one of the ways they did was they changed the person's name, you know? Abram became Abraham, you know, because he was transformed. You know, Jacob became Israel because he was transformed. Saul became Paul because he was transformed.
After all wrestling with the angels.
Yeah, after their dark nights, after their experience, you know, they were changed. Another way was they made them disappear and then reappear, you know, in another, you know, later in another book or something like that. So the prophet Elijah, who is this warlike warrior, who gets into the ultimate smackdown with the prophets of Baal, you know, and he has they have this. It's one of the fun reads in the Hebrew text, but they have this contest, and they go like, okay, build an altar and have your God make a fire, you know, and they built an altar and their gods couldn't make a fire. And then Elijah says, watch this. And he builds an altar and then he throws water on top of it. And then he says, God, build a fire. And poof, it goes into fire. And so he has them all executed. And then Jezebel, who is the queen at the time, who was a Baal follower, you know, puts out a warrant for his execution. So he runs to the hills and he hides in a cave and waits for instructions from God. You know, the only thing God says to him is like, what are you doing here? You're supposed to be out there. You know, you're a prophet. Get out there. Hey, what are you doing? Like two or three times he says to him, what are you doing here? And then that's the last we hear of Elijah.
Huh.
Until the second book of Kings, in the second chapter, he comes back, only he's this wise elder, no longer the warrior, but he's a wise elder. So they make him go away and come back.
Wow.
The third technique that the ancient scriptures use is that they make the person unrecognizable to their closest friends and family. You know, so Joseph is transformed. And he recognizes his brothers immediately. His brothers don't know who the hell he is, even though he's talking to them, right? They don't recognize
him.
You know, Jesus gets transformed and, you know, he sees Mary afterwards and she doesn't recognize him. How's that possible? She was his best friend, his number one, you know, disciple, research shows. So anyway, so those were the so I started looking at, you know, scripture and saying, you know, like, is this new or is it something that's been around forever? And I think it's been around forever. So transformation is a human process that we go through.
Right.
So if there's something that's the thread through it all is how do we transform, you know, how do men transform their, you know, kind of unthinking, you know, experiential focused way to become relationship partners. Right. How do we transform spiritually, or how do we transform our ego and our way of being in the world of work as in Typhoon Honey? So I think that's the common thread, kind of a wordy response to a
It was a good response. I think it sort of mapped them all out. Probably people in the audience are curious about your other books now too. Because I think when we start thinking about transformation and then we hear someone like you and we start thinking, wow, so all the levels of transformation are important for us to start imagining and looking at.
Yeah.
So, you know, for myself, I've been a Unitarian my whole life. And by being Unitarian, growing up Unitarian, it was sort of, we understood that the science and art sort of being a Unitarian is to explore mm-hmm. and to examine other ways of being religious and spiritual.
Right.
And so it was a pretty cool way to grow up. And I found my way back to the Unitarian Church, which I never actually left. But I have explored a lot of different spirituality and a lot of different religions. And, mm-hmm. you know, so it just suits me to be a Unitarian.
What I love about Universalism, you know, Unitarian Universal, is that it finds a place where there's a common thread among all the different spiritual practices. And that's really the truth. You know, in my view, if something is the truth, it's true for everybody. It's true in all situations. It's not my truth, and you know, like the Methodists have a truth, and it's the right truth, you know, and or the Catholics have a truth, or the Buddhists have a truth, you know, like,
and it's the only truth.
No, it's, you know, if it's true everywhere. And so,
Chris, we have somebody who's wants to ask a question on wisdom.
Sure.
Do you want to see what they have to say?
Sure do.
Let's see who it is. It's Kris. Kris, he's a coalition builder and founder of Bringing Humanity Together, always eager to share firsthand the story that inspired my powerful vision. Hi, Kris. Let's see if he's up here yet. Let's tap on. Oh, I have to select him. Yes. Okay. All right. Here he comes. One. Whoops. Did I not tap him?
So just 3, 2, 1, there he
is. I'm like, wait. Up there. Okay, he's there. I just didn't see his picture. Hi, Kris. Now this is a first time experience for me doing this on Wisdom and live on LinkedIn at the same time. So I think what I have to do is relate your question to Kris. So do you have a question for Kris? Are you there?
I'm here.
Okay. Do you have a question for Kris?
Well, it's more like maybe an observation, because I've been hearing what I've been talking about, and it really goes right up into my alley of my issue, passion, and purpose.
Okay. Hang on one sec.
I'm hearing him. I'm hearing
you. You can hear him? Okay.
Yeah. Go ahead, Kris.
Okay. Go ahead, Kris.
Thank you. The way I approach transformation, and this is the way that I've always viewed it, and really it's inspired me, like I said, to create Bringing Humanity Together in and of itself. When we allow the things that's in our lives just to be naturally there for what's already there, and we don't put nothing more into it or try to take something out of it, we just let it be. And I truly believe that we can meet people where they're at and take them for who they are. And when we extend that invitation to connect, whether it be physical or a social media connection request or whatever that might be, by meeting them where they are and taking them for who they are, and really understanding the model of the world that they work under, and allowing that kind of environment to kind of just let it be and let it grow and thrive from that kind of context. And if that works in the model of the world that you work under, I truly believe, Heidi and Kris, that what comes then before us is the very definition of change, which is transformation. And not only is that a gift to be shared, but also that's something that can be cultivated by all involved, whether it be through an opportunity, whether it be through a conversation, because you just never know through the power of what you do, whether it be through the lens of the power of positivity, the power of possibility, and see how truly interconnected everything is. And once you see how everything is interconnected to one to the next, then not only will that transformational be far more powerful than what you originally intended to be, but then you will get so much more back, because I truly believe as well that the very act of giving is in the very act of receiving.
You're spot on with that, Kris. And what I'm hearing also behind what you're saying is that you allow other people to change you, to transform you. When we allow for them and we don't come in with a preconceived notion of I am I and I'm not going to change and I'm, you know, like I'm this fixed entity, but rather meet people where they are and allow them in, you know, like a good dialogue between two people changes both people in the dialogue. You know, a good encounter like that really transforms us because we allow that other person inside of us to move things and shift things inside us so that we experience their true being and we then become authentic with them. So I totally agree with what you're saying, that that's really part and parcel of how we continually are transforming if we're aware and present at all times to all people when we're going through life.
Did you have
I appreciate that.
You have anything you want to add to that, Kris?
Oh, absolutely. I appreciate that, Kris, from that insight, because like I said, if you meet people where they are and you take them for who they are, and you lay the groundwork and you create the environment that is going to be in that kind of win-win dynamic. And the way I share it with people, Kris and Heidi, is if we can create environments that people will love, not only in our workplaces, but in our very communities. See, think how interconnected that really is right there in and of itself.
Right.
The very people that we work with, or more often than not, the very same people that we live with in our very communities. It's already there. A community is in our organizations by default and by very definition. And also, when we are in our day-to-day, going to the store or going to the bank or whatever that kind of process lays out for us in our daily lives, we have a huge opportunity to extend that invitation to connect. Because I dare say, Heidi and Kris, we're already connected. We're already there.
Right.
And see, what didn't allow us to get to that point is I truly believe it's two people. Number one is us. We actually put obstacles in our way far more than we understand and realize, and we do it constantly. Why? I will never know. But that's one thing that we have to answer that for ourselves is, why am I self-sabotaging myself to connect and meet people where they're at? Really have that great human connection. And then number two, it's the other dynamic. It's of we are letting others literally define not only our reality, but defining of how we connect and do the things that we do in our lives. And see, sometimes when they feed into that negativity to such an extent, and we allow that negativity in our state of being, in our mindset, and what we do on a day-to-day basis, that creates that kind of reality. The next thing you know, you will leap right into that reality of what other people have dictated for you because you don't know what else to do.
Right.
But see, if you're willing to let all that go and you have nothing to fear, I truly believe then you have nothing to lose. Because if you let go of those preconceived ideas, willing to let go of the control, willing to let go of that very destructive and fearful kind of mindset that you always are saying, oh, I can't do this because I don't have the mindset or the knowledge or whatever the case may be or whatever. It's almost to the point to get into the coulda, woulda, shoulda kind of game. But when the transformation comes before us.
Yeah. Yeah. And you're play.
Yeah, I think you just know who you are and why you do what you do. And I've been getting this on a lot on social media apps today, right now, for the past like couple of weeks. And we even brought it up in one of our LinkedIn Lives this week on Sharon Carer Sandy, that I host with my partner Sandy Chernoff from British Columbia in Canada. We were talking about it's not what we do, it's who we are. And right. I believe when it comes to transformation, when people see who we truly are is not what we do, the doing part is just a component of that.
Right.
And once people see that, that transformative opportunity will be far more exponential in scope. Like all the time in human history, because you're not really in the driver's seat, so to speak. You're just basically an observer and bystander, but willing to take the reins when that opportunity presents itself and to say, hey, I want to connect with Heidi. I want to connect with Kris. And by doing that and letting that be, that is the greatest gift that we can not only bestow onto others, mm-hmm. but also that we can receive it in turn as well.
Yeah, and there are a couple of things I want to pick up on in what you're talking about, Kris. You know, first off, you're absolutely right that a lot of that comes from fear-based. You know, a lot of the negativity, a lot of the resistance that we have to each other, you know, is a fear. You know, it comes from the source of fear that we live by, and you know, fear is just a natural state of the brain because you know its primary function is to, you know, keep us surviving. And so it's always looking for what's going to eat me, what's going to kill me, what's going to do damage to me. And so the brain kind of makes up this fear-based thing. So, you know, that's one element of it. But I think early on, you said something that I firmly live by, and it's a statement from the Buddha. And he said, you know, though we're different, we were born involved with each other. You know, that connection that's naturally there, if we surrender the fear and just experience each other from a place of beingness. And the, you know, that's the third thing I wanted to relate in this whole weave here, is that the core of transformation teaching is the phrase be, do, have. You know, most people live life, if I had enough money, I could do the things that would be fun and I would be happy. Instead of saying, if I am happy, you know, if I start from a place of being, then I'll be doing the things that, you know, that produce the have at the end, that there's a result of that. So when you blend all those things together, Kris, I think you're, you know, like where you're coming from is identical to what, you know, what we do in transformation training, is, you know, it's really trying to meet people where they are, but also to bring where you are as fully present into that same thing, so that in the encounter between those two beings, that we actually have a chance to affect each other and move forward to towards a creative new that isn't you or isn't me, but you know, or isn't dictated by my ego or dictated by yours, but actually a joint effort of the two of us together in relationship. And that's really, you know, a transformative, powerful relationship that you can create there. Thanks for that comment. That's really great.
Yeah, Kris, do you want to land the plane real quick? Because we just I'm going to move forward with the discussion with Kris. But was there something you wanted to add?
I would like to do this with both of you. I would like to keep this great and engaging conversation moving forward. I've already sent you a connection with Kris Ivy on LinkedIn. And Kris, I think let's all three get on a meet and greet call. And let's keep this conversation moving forward, because I got some great points that I want to share with both of you even more so on this. Mm-hmm. So yeah, let's keep the conversation going.
I'm always up for that.
Yeah, we can do a Zoom and have a chat and talk about greater stuff for the future.
Oh, absolutely. I welcome that. So Kris, thank you so much for talking about Transformation Day. I can't wait to meet you in person, whether it be on video or through a phone call.
Yeah.
Let's not only bring humanity together, let's bring humanity into business and beyond, and do it through the prism of not only transformation, but also by meeting people where they are and making them who they are.
Yeah. Absolutely. And I have a channel on Wisdom that I just started called Transformation Talk. And I've only started this week. I'm new to Wisdom, so you know, be happy to invite you into that, and we could have some dialogue on that live. I just noticed that my friend Yuka has come into the chat on the side over here, and Yuka, we just started, so you know, welcome to the conversation, and feel free to post questions or
Yeah, absolutely.
I don't know if you can bring her in live or anything like that.
I think I can. Let's see. Let me go to a different screen here. Does she have, you can give her the link.
Okay, I could do that. Okay, all right, of course.
Yeah, and you can make it the three-way up here.
I don't know how to do that, so you get to do that.
All right, as long as she has the link. Oh, wait, here we can invite her.
I just sent it.
Okay, good.
Well, I sent that on email.
Private chat.
There we are.
Yeah, with that link. So she can jump in.
If you'd like.
Yeah. Next week. Oh, there's you guys. See her in the comments. In the chat. Oops, no, I don't want to do that. All right. So this is a bit rough and ready. So
while you're working on that.
Yes. I wanted to ask you about your co-worker, your co-author, and how that relationship came to be, that you guys decided you were going to collaborate on a book. I want to hear that story because I love Candace. And
So long ago and far away, I did transformation training back in the late 80s, early 90s. And when Candace decided that she wanted to bring transformation back to Boston, because she had just recently, about 5, 6, 7 years ago, had gone through a series of transformation trainings and said, this is amazing stuff, and I want to bring it to my husband's hometown. Her husband Andrew is from Boston. They started calling people who are graduates of the programs that were here in Boston before, and so they called me up and said, "Hey, you want to come play?" And they said, "Sure, but here's my conditions." Back in the old days when we did transformation training, the way we would staff the programs was, the people who just graduated from a program would say, "Hey, you're all excited and everything like that. Hi, Yuka. Come join us and be staff on the other thing." But we did nothing to train them or prepare them or help them with that. So the turnover rate, the burnout was just, horrible. And I said, coming in, I want to create the materials so that people don't burn out, so that they have the tools to be able to be coaches, to be able to be staff, volunteers, and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So I started writing a lot of that material. And then Candace, was looking at it. She goes, "This is really good stuff. You ought to make a book out of it." And I said, "Yeah, we ought to do that." And she said, "Oh no, I can't write." And I said, "Sounds like a self-limiting belief to me."
Yeah, right. Exactly.
We had a good laugh about that. And so she started trying her hand at it. And the way it was written was, I'd write a piece of it, then she would write the, kind of the character stories around it and bring that in. And then we would blend it together and read it to each other over a period of 2 years and stuff. So it came out of building the materials to train the coaches for Boston Breakthrough Academy. And was a labor of love, based on, just wanting to, put that all in one place, because we didn't find any source that had all those tools and all that backdrop all together. So we went out and created it.
Wow. Okay. Now I have to read the book.
Yes.
Yeah. Have you read it, Yuka?
Not yet.
She's a proud owner of a copy, but she hasn't read it yet.
Yes.
Yeah. Now I'm much more fascinated by the idea and more excited to read it. So I'm definitely going to get a copy to read. I'm very excited about that. So you guys, the two of you here, thank you, Yuka, for joining us. Tell us a little bit about your transformational connection. I know, since I know Kris so well, I know that your connection is transformational. So yeah. I don't even have to ask.
Let me explain you first why I didn't read the book, because I didn't have time. I don't have time because I am in the training right now.
You're in
She's in BBA right now.
Yeah. Oh, me too.
Really? I'm a B14.
So, I'm B15.
Right, and I'm coaching B16. So there you go. 14, right 15, 16, after you. Right? But but Yuka and I have been friends for a long time, and then 5-6 years ago, I was doing a consulting thing in Spain, in Barcelona, and Yuka lives just outside of Barcelona, so you know, it was a chance to visit and stay at her house, and I always had thought Yuka was a translator. You know, because she speaks a whole bunch of different languages and not easy ones, you know, like Spanish and English and Japanese and, you know, Catalan. So I always admired her linguistic abilities, and I thought that's what she was. And so we decided while I was there for the training and stayed for the weekend, we decided to drive up to Montserrat. And along the way, we're chatting back and forth. So what are you doing lately? And Yuka's saying, well, I'm, you know, working with people on emotional intelligence and how emotional intelligence is really linguistically and culturally based. And I go, no, that's my job. That's what I do. I teach emotional intelligence to executives. And I've been telling them, you know, like, you can't just assume that it's the same in Spain as it is in the United States. And you know, so we discovered that we were, you know, both teaching the same thing from different perspectives, you know, from, you know, Yuka coming from the globalization, localization world, and me coming from the executive coaching world. We are both actually having the same conversation with audiences. So we decided that we would work together and do some stuff. And we've done some conference presentations, and we've done some course development for different people and stuff like that. So we became kind of business partners along the way as well. So
Before is that a fair one? We knew each other for about, I don't know, decades?
Yeah, at least.
Decade, wow.
Yeah, 2 decades.
2 decades, yeah, probably, yeah.
So it was a revelation that how much we don't know the people. You think
you know somebody, and you know, like, my knowledge of or my thoughts about Yuka were all made up. I just, you know, I just knew her as a friend of Sarah's, my wife, and I knew that she, you know, spoke English so well, and you know, was Japanese, and at the time had been married to a French guy, and you know, like, so like had all these different language abilities, and I just made it up that she must be a translator.
I am, you know, but the component is like culture, language, and functions.
Yeah.
That's the whole mix. And culture is heavily, heavily influenced by emotions.
Yeah. And you're gracious and understating your skills. Mm-hmm. Yuka is a strategic consultant, and she really is insightful and looked up to by many people in the globalization world as one of the experts on culture and its impact on business and interactions and stuff. So, you know, it's my honor to always get to work with her, because I learn every time I talk to her.
Me too. Thank you very much for your insight. I mean, globalization people really welcomed Kris, and he comes into our industry and teaches what we don't know. And we were talking about mental health before the war happened, and then when the war in Europe happened, we could quickly put together mental health, maintaining your mental health in crisis session. Mm-hmm. So he is well respected in localization and globalization. And thank you very much for your work. I truly appreciate
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, something, someone's name came to mind when you were talking about that, and that's Marshall. Is it Marshall Goldsmith, the one that talks about peaceful nonviolent, it's the word, it's when you learn how to converse with people, nonviolent, it's not called nonviolent conversation, no, but he has worked with warring tribes in Russia and in Africa, and taught them to, like, he brings people to the table who hate and despise one another and whose two cultures are always at war. And I think he did a lot. I wish I could remember his name directly. I've been on meetups that are teaching people this kind of communication, nonviolent communication.
Yeah.
And it's Marshall.
I don't know that one. It's not Marshall Goldsmith, but it sounds an awful lot like Adam Kahane, who was at, oh my God, what's the company that he worked for? He started off in Royal Dutch Shell, and then went to Cap Gemini is where he was. But he was one of the foundational mediators at the Montfleur Dialogues for the Peace and Reconciliation talks post-apartheid. He was one of the key facilitators of Vision Guatemala. When they brought, and the way they work, what you're describing is very similar to what Kahane does. The way he works is they get all of the factors, all of the different points of view in the room. So literally in Vision Guatemala, they had village, women from the villages whose husbands had been murdered by the death squads. They had the commanders of the death squads. They had the generals of the army, they had the religious leaders, they had the, all of the different factions that were part of the whole Guatemalan culture. In this conversation, one of the participants was so afraid to be part of the discussion that he only came in by phone. He was only on the phone with them, but, and he was one of the leaders of the death squads. But in order to create a whole transformation, a whole movement forward, it was necessary for all of them to hear each other's story. Mm. And so they spent weeks just telling each other their story, and that's, that's kind of what Kris was talking about, meeting people where they are, that ability to sit and listen to the pain of somebody else that you may have caused, really in itself is transformative.
I remembered his name is Marshall Rosenberg. And there are videos of him doing his talks all over the world on YouTube. And there are people who have been trained, and this man you're talking about may have been trained by Marshall Rosenberg. He was called into warring tribes in Africa to help them resolve their wars and to address one another and speak with respect to one another and learn more deeply what had triggered what was happening. Mm-hmm. And so that it's a different kind of cultural transformation. And all of these types of transformation we've been talking about, spiritual, religious, physical, emotional, and now, cultural transformation is just a magnificent movement. And there are so many cogs, gears and mental, and mental plateaus. And
or entry steps. Portals, any different entry ways portals. To get into
yes.
it. Yeah.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Wow. It's amazing. There could be, we could add all these new portals like dance. There could be a portal that's known as dance your way into transformation.
Well, isn't that there is. Stuff around dance therapies and dance as a form of transformation. There's also spiritual dance. There's also, you know, the dervishes who, you know, get into a transformed state, a state transformation by, you know, their whirling dance, you know, that really induces a trance in them. So, you know, so dance has been a part of human transformation and human experience for since there's been music and drumming, you know, which is since we've been collecting together as groups.
I just thought of someone when we repeat this, when I have all the technology or aligned so that I can easily get questions from people on Wisdom, and I've got different screens so that I can get questions from people on LinkedIn Live and YouTube and Facebook. So we'll be back on again, and I'm going to invite someone who's probably doesn't, you know, he probably does consider himself a wheel of transformation in the world, but it's Stephen Harms. And he helps people to, he lifts them up through their voice. He says that everyone can sing. They just don't understand their instrument yet. And so he teaches people to sing. And that is transformative for people. So I'm going to invite Stephen when we do this again. I'll invite him to be the fourth party here.
Wow. You know, I stream as well, live stream. But what I don't want to do is dance in the live streaming or sing in the live streaming. So that's kind of, you know, barriers to breakthrough.
It'll be fun, right?
Right.
Maybe Stephen will get us all singing.
All singing, right, right.
If I know him, he probably will.
Wow.
Are you ready for that, Yuga?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay.
The challenge taken, I mean, like, accepted.
Challenge accepted.
You got it, yeah.
Do you accept this stretch?
Yes, I do.
I reach for it. I stretch for it.
So I have a question, you know, for, you know, put the two of you on the spot. I've been a coach in Boston Breakthrough Academy. You guys are both in a class of Boston Breakthrough Academy. And I just would ask each of you, you know, briefly to describe what is shifting inside you as you're going through this experience. What do you notice as the shift or the, you know, we don't dare look at ourselves and say, oh, I'm transforming, but we do notice that it's shifting. There's stuff that's moving around in here. It's only in retrospect when we go like, oh my God, that was so transformative, you know. But so my question to you guys each is, what do you notice shifting in you?
You want to go first, Yuka?
Oh yeah, of course. You know, I'm going through breakthroughs and breakthroughs and breakthroughs, like small to big, every week. The truth is that I don't even remember how I was before. I just don't remember. You know, I went through so much. And people notice, only calling on the phone or WhatsApp, without any image, people already notice that, yeah, from your voice, I can notice something, you know? So something has happened. Something, just one or two I guess many shifts happened, adjusting. The truth is, I don't know, you tell me, Kris. You saw me doing that, so maybe you know. But, you know, I finally grounded, I think, this weekend. or last week, I'm not no longer agitated, and anxiety disappeared. Today I noticed I'm calmer, and I, after the breakthrough weekend, I started to sleep. I couldn't sleep long hours, like every two or three hours I was waking up, but that pattern disappeared like a magic. Now I can sleep straight, like before.
Wow.
Wow.
So I don't know, except for that, I guess lots of things happened, but I don't know. I put some weight, that's for sure.
You did what?
A little.
Oh.
I put some weight, so I'm a little more round, like rounder the face. But yeah, so next.
Okay. Yeah, I've got a lot of things that have shifted for me. I noticed that, well, I had some very big shifts while I was still in the training. And I mean, while I was in the very beginning, I had a night where I almost, this voice said, screw this. It wasn't working out the way I wanted. I wasn't getting the things I went in and planned to get. And when that happened, I was just angry. I was just, and I was in this closed eye process. So I didn't want anybody to see that I had my eyes open and it was on Zoom. So I went, and I was looking for the withdraw. I was looking for close, leave the room. And then this little voice, I don't know, in here, this little tiny voice said, oh, no, you don't. Oh, no, you don't.
This is where you always quit.
Yes, this, exactly. Oh, my God. This is where you always quit.
Yeah.
Don't quit. And then I was like, all right, fine. I'll quit in the morning. So, and I was grumbly all night after that. And in the morning, I woke up and I was like, yes, oh my God, I'm so glad I didn't quit. Oh my God, there is so much happening for me here now. There is so much happening, so much available. And I'm starting to begin to see who I really am underneath all of this ego painting, you know, this. I was always a broadcaster about being present moment awareness and breathing and laughter, but it was all superficial. It was all just on the surface of Heidi. And underneath, Heidi was depressed. Heidi was feeling not enough, a lot. And Heidi was, I'm speaking in third person now, I recognize that. I was... basically, I could have been diagnosed with depression for the last 20 years. I would drive around town and go, okay, this would be a good place at 4 a.m. where I could just drive off the road, you know, drive off the bridge. And that was sort of this running dialogue in the back of my head for 20 years. Mm. And it started with chronic pain. But then even when the chronic pain was gone, that habitual little voice was still present. You're not enough. You're not good enough. You're not strong enough. You're not important enough. How dare you think you do that? How dare you? You know, you'll never get that. And then so when I woke up in the morning, I'm like, this voice gets to be shrunken, gets to be recognized. You know, this little voice that spoke up and told me to stop, I want to go into that voice deeper. I want to get to know that voice, that part of Heidi. Mm. That is the courageous part of Heidi. And so when I woke up in the morning, I was so excited. I was so happy to be alive. I just, it was amazing. It was just that, just that one experience was probably the biggest transformation through the whole, but now it's really easy. Now I know, okay, I'm going to go to bed.
There it is again. There it is again.
I'm going to bed because I know when I wake up, I'll remember who I am.
You know, the thing about that, Heidi, is that we all have the I'm not enough. And the reason is very simple. It's that we learn 90% of our vocabulary before the age of five. And therefore, 90% of our concepts about the world we learn with that vocabulary before the age of five. And so what we learn is the world is big and fast and strong and smart, and I'm not.
We might get cut off.
Yeah, right. Oh, yeah?
Yeah, because our hour is up.
Our hour's up. Anyway, so
Oh no! Did it just start again? Yeah, we're still going. We're good.
All right. I have until
Sorry
two. I have to get off at two. But anyway, so because we learn all about the world when we're learning our vocabulary, you know what we learn is that we're not big, fast, strong, smart. You know, whatever the world is, we're not powerful like our parents. We exercise our power by saying no or mine or whatever, you know, those power words that kids, the kids use that we call the terrible twos. They're just trying to find some sense of ownership and power in the world because they feel so small, right?
Yeah.
So what happens as a result of that is we form this kind of inferiority thought about ourselves that we're not enough. We're not big enough. We're not fast enough. We're not strong enough. Mm. And we do one of two things for the rest of our lives. We either go like, oh, I guess I'm not enough, you know, Eeyore, you know, or we say, oh, yeah, watch this. And we go out and we try to prove ourselves and try to prove ourselves and try to prove ourselves over and over and over again. And it's a never ending battle because we, you know, the fundamental belief inside is I'm not enough.
Mm.
Right. And we all have it. You know, it's just learning that, oh, that's a normal thing that kids do. And I'm not a child anymore. I'm not 5 years old anymore.
Right.
You know, and so now I am enough.
Yeah. But by chance, do you have it, Kris?
Do I have what?
That voice.
I'm not enough? Oh, by chance? Yeah.
Yeah, by chance.
You know, like that's like saying, Kris, are you a human? Yeah, I got it. You know, I have the same disease as you do. You should read my resume. It's so freaking cool. You know, it's so full of things, you know, like I'm on a men's team and the power of my men's team is that we've been together for a long, long time and we all know each other's shtick, you know, and my shtick is I'm always doing something. And one of the guys on my team once said to me, it's like, when are you going to stop doing so much and trying to prove that you're something? And I go, I'm not trying to prove my something. And he said, wait a minute. No, you did this and 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 you did that, you know, like, and they start listing off all the different accomplishments, you know, things that I call them resume bullet points, you know, things that you'll put on your resume, you know, like running the marathon, you know, being a black belt in Taekwondo, you know, just all these different things that I just continued to do even into my 60s. And finally, you know, he said, when's it going to be enough? You know, what's it going to be? When are you going to be enough for yourself? And I go like, well, maybe now, you know, maybe I don't have to get any more trophies, you know? I have a fitness room downstairs. It's full of trophies.
Yeah.
Seriously, medals and trophies and things like that. And
yeah, that's the reason why I asked, because you did so much, you achieved so much, you won so much, you know.
Mm-hmm. But it's a lot of it comes just from that natural human quality of feeling like, well, I have to show that I am something. I have to show that I am.
Wow. Maybe that disease.
Yeah.
I have it as well.
Yeah. Well, And it's, you know, it's probably that we all have it. The question is, what do we do with it?
Mm-hmm.
You know, the question is, do we let it run us? Or do we say, you know, I finally recognize that that's a 5-year old response. And I'm not 5 anymore. I'm going to be 73 in just a few weeks. You know, it's just like, I'm not 5 anymore. I'm okay. You know, I don't need to prove myself. I don't write books. I'm sorry. Say again, Yuga.
No, you're not 5, but you're just 6, you know.
I'm 6 now. No. Right, I'm 6.
Well, we still have that little child in us, right?
Yeah, right. We all do. Yeah. You know, and it's alive and well. And you know, the thing that we do get to do is to hug and love that 5-year-old who just made up all those thoughts of I'm not enough because she, or in my case, he, you know, felt little. And so, you know, once we accept that that's, you know, where it came from, you know, then we're able to stop the strife, the struggle, to you know, for accomplishments, and just do what we do because, you know, it's who we be, it's who we are, you know, and allow that to be okay. Okay.
I find this so fascinating. So fascinating, because I am Japanese living in Spain. I'm talking to you guys in the States, and the foundation is exactly the same. Mm-hmm. You know, so this is fascinating.
Yeah.
I mean, what is the difference? What is the common ground?
We are all human, even though our cultures shape us differently.
Mm-hmm.
Our humanity has more in common than our cultures have different.
Interesting. Very, very interesting.
Yeah, we all bleed the same blood color. You know, we all feel pain the same. You know, except for us who are superhuman and don't feel pain at all. I guess our humanity is what keeps us as one, recognizing. Mm-hmm. And that's the possibility that's always there, is that we can eventually all begin to recognize that we are one race. You know, we are the human
race. Yes.
Yeah. Eventually, without
fighting.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Recognizing that when we use weapons against someone else, we're actually using them against our family.
Yeah.
You know.
Sure.
Yeah. We've just got a really big family. We've got 8 billion in our family.
Yeah, right. Right.
You know.
Do you know that 99.9% of your DNA and my DNA are identical? There's only 99.9% of your DNA thread is identical to mine.
I love that.
It's only the 1/10 or the 1/10 of a percent that makes blue eyes and brown eyes and gray hair and green, you know, eyes and tall and short and dark skin and light skin. And,
wow.
You know, all of those variations are only 1/10 of a percent of the DNA strand.
Oh, my God.
That's the reason why we are so similar.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
You know?
Yeah.
I want to have a big dinner. Now that's what I want to do. I want to have like a table, like 20 tables with 100 people each.
Who does that? There was, I saw a video, and there must have been 200 tables in a row.
Wow.
And all these people sitting down to a meal, you know, all different kinds of people, all different, you know, skin colors and backgrounds and heights and ages and things like that, all coming to table. And I'm trying to think of who did that. But I remember I saw it just last year, I think, somewhere on it was on a YouTube or a Facebook or something, wow. You know, someplace. But yeah, what an amazing, you know, meal to celebrate humanity, you know, that we're all one.
Oh my God. And we could do it in stadiums and fields all around the world and time it, you know, so that I guess everybody wouldn't want to eat at exactly the same time, but within a 24-hour span, every hour around the planet, people are sitting down to a meal with 2,000 people there or more.
Yeah, right.
You know, wow. And that it's a possibility. We can
generate this. We saw, you know, women around the world reacting, you know, to the pink hat movement, you know, the Me Too movement, things like that, where, you know, in every, you know, major city in every country around the world, there was, you know, there were gatherings of women speaking out for women's rights. And that was only 2 years ago.
Yeah.
You know, so I mean, when the movement is ripe, you know, people will come to the table.
You
know? Yeah. You know, I reserved a domain name that might be perfect for this.
God love you. I love you, Heidi.
Be the changeapalooza.com.
Be the changeapalooza.com.
Wow.
Would you go to dinner at Be the Changeapalooza? Oh my God. Oh, well, it sounds like we would have music there. It sounds like there would be children playing there.
Yeah.
Doesn't it? It sounds like there would be transformative game playing there.
Yeah. And you know, I started to host this lunch events in 2019, a year before the pandemic. And my group is becoming bigger and bigger. Like in local roster, I have 100 people. So if you call, maybe people are interested in. I mean, and this is a global movement in my industry. So what you said, like every city has the same exact format of meal. And networking.
Yes.
And we are doing in every city. So yeah,
I love it.
Yeah.
How many chapters now are there for is it Look World or Look Lunch? Yeah.
I don't know. Dozens, because we have Africa, we have Middle East, Europe, of course, USA, in the South America.
What's it called, Yuka?
Look Lunch. LOC. Lunch, because this is from localization industry. Localization is to take the product, fix it in such a way to be sold in the market, in another market. Mm-hmm. So we have to localize it. We have to make it local so that we can sell. Like Microsoft Excel to be sold outside the USA. You have to fix the language and the format of the date, format of the you know, the decimal points, and all the kind of stuff. So that's what we do more or less.
Yeah.
There's an industry called localization, and this is where I'm driving this launch movement.
Wow. Well, I wonder if there's somebody in our audience that is already reaching out to us and saying, I want to do this. Let's do this. Let's make this happen.
Do it. Yeah.
And I'm going to say, if there's anybody listening on Wisdom and you want to be the one, the driving engine behind this idea, jump up, ask to speak right now, and I'll bring you into the conversation.
What is the theme of the meal?
What is what? The theme of the meal. The theme of the meal is
I am you and you are me. Yeah. Be the change.
Be the change. Yeah. Oh, wow.
Unite together. You know, this is, I also started another thing called Pinky Ribbon Promise. And that was where you tie a curly Q ribbon to your pinky, whatever color you want. Yeah. You just tie it, you know, like the ones you make for Christmas, and you tie them and you make them curly so that when you're typing on your keyboard, you see it and it goes into your imagination. You go, oh yeah, that's right. And that's what you do when you catch, when your eye catches the pinky ribbon. You close your eyes, you take a breath. Your breath is a gift to your body. So you give yourself a gift. You relax your shoulders, you breathe out, and then you can go right back to work. But you do it throughout the day. Every time you see that pinky ribbon, that reminds you to give yourself a gift of oxygen, of a moment, of a breath, of some peace, even if it's only for a few seconds, of an opportunity to breathe. And so having that pinky ribbon on your finger and declaring to the world that, you know, I'll have six of them on my hand so that somebody's going to say, why are you wearing all those ribbons? What does this mean something? And then I get to pass it on. Because what a great thing to pass on. I keep getting chills.
Do you remember the movie It's a Wonderful Life? You remember the movie It's a Wonderful Life?
Oh, of course.
And Uncle Billy had strings on all of his fingers. he was always forgetting stuff. So put a string here and put a string there, and then he would never remember what string was for what thing he had to remember.
Yes. Yeah. I think once you make the commitment and you say, this is my gift to myself, I'm going to join this pinky ribbon promise. And then once you start realizing how powerful it is for you, and somebody says in the line at the bank or whatever, we don't have those much anymore, but they're in line at the bank and, you know, somebody says, what are all the, why do you have two pinky ribbons on? You just, oh, let me tell you about this. This has been such a huge gift to myself. I'm so glad I did it. I can tell you about it.
Oh, so yeah.
That's, I love your creativity.
Yeah, right.
So while it'll grow on its own accord, it's not like I have to do a whole lot. I just get to talk about it once in a while. Yeah. And people can start doing it if they feel like it.
Yeah.
There's not even a website there yet, but I have pinkyribbonpromise.com. So if somebody wants to volunteer, send me a private message, and you can build a beautiful website that explains the Pinky Ribbon Promise. And that's how we transform the world. PinkyRibbonPromise.com. And these Loke lunch all around the world. You know, we pick a day and then we just let it happen.
Yeah.
We let each city.
Your Loke lunches are monthly or the quarter?
Yes. And I'm trying to do two right now, one at lunchtime, the other in the evening, because sometimes people can't escape from their work.
Oh, so you do two a month, one in the afternoon and one in the evening?
Yeah, at lunchtime and evening. And I have a team. I can't do it all by myself. I have a team. I have two more people managing with me. Otherwise, it's impossible because all the obligations and work and everything.
That's how many people are there usually at your gatherings?
Before the lockdown, I usually gather like 30 people. And sometimes there's like nearly 40 for lunch. But when we were hitting that, we went straight to lockdown. So right now, this month, I did an evening event with drinks. It was 26 people.
That's good.
Yeah, that's
awesome.
So, and when you just says lockdown in Spain, you got a serious fine if you're outside your house.
Oh, yeah.
Not on business, you know, like 200 euros or something like that.
Yeah.
What was it?
I don't remember. I think it was 90. I don't know. Because I wasn't fined.
Yeah, of course.
You know, I wasn't.
You're a good, obedient person.
Yeah. It was so strict, and the police was patrolling, you know, like watching. And so, yeah, people didn't go out.
Yeah. Really. We weren't, I was in Ireland. We weren't allowed to take the bus. You know, you could go two kilometers on the bus, and that was it. You couldn't be go beyond 2 kilometers. You couldn't cross from one county to another.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. So it was pretty strict. And I wasn't there during the first official lockdown. I was in England for that. And we were a little worried. We went on a road trip to a different part of Dorset County. And we were both going, are we going to get pulled over? Are we going to get in trouble? I think you have to act like you're sick and we're going to the hospital. I was like, I don't want to do that. But she's like, we're going on a road trip. And that even if only a mile or two an hour, we're going to go. I was like, oh, I'm so nervous. I always had a mask on. Yeah, we ended up okay. And we found an ice cream truck that was open and in business. And it had this beautiful view. It was on top of this hill. And there were all these people, and they were all social distancing in line. But there were people in line waiting for ice cream. It was great.
Wow.
All these scoff laws.
Bad people.
Bad people.
So let's take a final crack at this, because I do jump off in 10 minutes.
Yes, and Typhoon Honey is, you know, I'm really excited about reading the book now.
Right.
Because I think it's going to take what I'm learning in the training, and I think Yuka's probably reflecting on this too, is that reading about it from you and Candace, you know, it's something about reading. You know, not listening, but reading. Mm. It takes from our brain, our eyes into our brain, into our heart. Mm-hmm. You know, and that just sounds like, oh yeah, I'm ready for that.
Yeah, I always like reading books that, you know, that I know the author, because I can read it in their voice, you know?
Yeah, yeah. So, I'm sure I'm going to hear your voice and narrating it for me.
Right. Yeah, right.
Are you going to publish the audiobook?
Yes. We are working on that. It's terrifically difficult to get. Candace is a high ranking rainmaker in a financial technology firm. She is a venture capitalist and angel investor. She is a new mom, a relatively newlywed. She's only 5 years or 6 years in her marriage, and then they run a bed and breakfast out of their house. And, I don't know. I actually swear that Candace Sogren is from the planet Krypton. If we pulled back her shirt, you would see a great big S there, because she is superhuman, but she is incredibly busy, and it's really difficult to nail her down to do the recording. So we're about 3/4 of the way done doing the chapter recordings. And it's just, you know, we kind of got into a very busy spot and, haven't been able to complete those, but we do want to do that, and I don't want to do it by myself. I want to do it with her, because we started off that way.
You don't want to do it all by yourself?
Mm.
Really?
No.
Well, one thing I've learned in the trainings is that it'll be perfect when it's finished.
It'll be coming together
and your timing and everything.
Yeah.
However it works out is perfect the way it works out.
Everything is.
Yeah.
You know, everything always is. So
So wrap up Typhoon Honey for us, Kris.
In the final chapter, we talk about what we call being source. And being source is a level of of accountability, of personal accountability in your life, where it's not just I own my shit, you know, I own what I've done, but that I look at everything as feedback on how I'm being, such that I could see myself as the source of everything that happens in my life. So let's say, for example, I have a commitment to not littering and to keeping the environment green, and I'm walking down the street and I see, you know, trash on the sidewalk. You know, the thought from source is, how is it possible that I'm being this way and people don't know that they shouldn't, you know, throw stuff on the sidewalk? So I need to raise my level of energy and my outspokenness about that, so that doesn't happen anymore, because I'm the source. You know, I see my job as, you know, if this is something I believe in, I'm going to take the position of being the source, you know. So I look at everything that happens to me and I say, all right, well, that's really good feedback. How was I being here? You know, how was I? Now, does being source mean that I look at my ownership in the Ukrainian war? No, you know, obviously I didn't create that. But if my source, if being source for me is being peace, you know, it has something to do with peace, then I see that as a point calling me forward in my stand to be a force for peace. And so I don't see myself as separate from it. I'm part of it because I'm source. So it's a level of accountability that's, you know, above like accountable, you know, and we call it being source. And so we send people off at the end of the book saying, all right, so this is our last chapter, but you write the next one because you're the source. And so I think what transformation allows us to do is to move from a place where stuff happens to me, you know, where I'm not enough, to I'm more than enough. I am ample, and I'm the source for how, if I want my life to turn out a certain way, I don't have to look any further than right here, you know, because that's, you know, I'm going to take ownership of that. Right.
Yeah. That's beautiful. That's very beautiful. Thank you so much. Thank you, Yuka. So nice of you to join us today. I really appreciate
you for having me.
Well, and it was really fun to have, you know, a little Boston Breakthrough kind of reunion and conversation here, and talk a little bit about that, since Typhoon Honey came from that same source.
Mm-hmm. No, I think it's, and I want to thank Kris Berryman. I don't know if he's still in the audience on Wisdom, but I look forward to expanding in that conversation with him in the future.
Great.
Having you both on again, and maybe adding Stephen Harms to the mix. That should be pretty interesting.
That would be fun, yeah.
Yeah, so I'll have to talk to Stephen and see if he's up for it. And, you know, creating something in the near future. Mm-hmm. And maybe having a copy of Typhoon Honey so I can hold it up.
Oh, there
you go.
Like this. Oh, there it is.
There it is. The only way out is through.
Right.
Typhoon Honey. Yeah, now I want to go meet Typhoon Honey in Thailand.
I do too. I really want to. We sent him a copy of the book.
Oh, good. Wow. I bet he was really moved.
I haven't heard.
Yeah, well, if he's always joyful and giggling, he probably was in an uproar, a flood of laughter
when he saw it. Took a little liberty at the end of the book and you know, created a little guided visualization as if Typhoon Honey were the tour guide. And it's sort of like a journey to the mountain and getting the insight you know, from the guru on the top of the mountain. And you know, there's a line in Winnie the Pooh where, you know, Pooh and Piglet are going to Pooh's house, and Pooh's all worried because he's not there. And the line is, and luckily Pooh was there just as they arrived. and so Typhoon Honey, it turns into being the guru just as we arrive at the top of the mountain. There he is sitting there waiting to teach us. And so we had a little fun with that guided fantasy. I hope he appreciates it.
And, you know, what a benchmark he has created by the way, his way of being.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's created a benchmark from which to be with people. It's awesome.
Great.
Well, thank you guys. I appreciate your time.
I must depart.
Yes.
Having a hard time staying in my
wisdom. I'm going to close this room. Thank you so much, both of you.
Bye.
Thank
you. Nice to see you.
Bye, Kris.
Nice seeing you.
Good to see you guys. Whoops. All
right. Bye.
Thank you. I'm going to close wisdom too. And thank you. Thank you. And thank you, everybody who's dropped in. Join me and my special guest next week, next Friday at 12:30 Eastern Time also. I will look for you then. I can't wait. I'll talk to you. Have a great weekend. Make it a great weekend. Set your intention. Be present. This is the only moment, and now this is the only moment that there is. Stay in the present. It's a beautiful gift. Close your eyes. Oh, feel that gift you have just given to your body. Enjoy it. Do it all weekend. Tie a ribbon to your pinky to remind yourself to give yourself that gift. Every day, throughout the day, why not? You are source for your sense of peace. I love you guys. Thank you for being here. I will see you next week. Big hug.